Good morning. It is great to see you all. Welcome. Thank you for taking your time today on a special day where we celebrate fathers. Thank you for taking time to join us. Thank you if you're online for joining, and just hope that it's an encouraging morning. I want to say happy Father's Day to you fathers out there. Thankful for the fathers, that especially the fathers that point us to our Heavenly Father. And I'm thankful for my dad and so many of you men that do that in the lives of all of us women and children here. But there is a special gift. The church has a little beef jerky stick for all the men, high school age and up. They get to participate in the little beef jerky stick. So we know how to make you men happy with a little bit of food, so we hope you enjoy it. Just want to encourage you this morning. They have a real nice QR code in your bulletin. If you would love to serve, or you would love to be a part, or just know what's going on, if you scan that QR code with your phone, it's a great way to get information. Also, we're really looking forward to July 23rd is our annual Family Day. And if you haven't been part of our Family Day, or maybe it's just something that you haven't practiced coming to because it's different, our North and South campuses get together, and honestly, it is a blast. We are having Cedarville's worship group, Heart Song, they're going to come and lead us in worship, and then we have Eric's going to bring a sermon to us all, and just we'll share together in worship and lunch. So mark your calendar. RSVP through the QR code, that will allow you to sign up for a t-shirt, for frozen yogurt. You just don't want to miss that. So just why don't you stand with us as we worship our wonderful Heavenly Father this morning.
We're the most free when we're bound for glory.
World is not my home. I'm here but for a moment. It's all I've ever known. But this world is not my home. This fight is not my own. These burdens are my future. The empty tomb has shown I am bound for glory.
I am free.
Oh, I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory.
The saving work is done.
The saving work is done. Death is not my ending. My God has overcome, and I am bound for glory. I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for bound for glory.
Think about this truth today. All my pain,
hurt and shame, called with Jesus, calls my name. Endless joy, endless praise, all with Jesus, calls my name. All my pain, hurt and calls my name. Endless joy and endless praise, Lord, when Jesus calls my name. I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory. Oh, I am free because I'm bound. I am bound for heaven's gate, where my feet will stand on holy ground. I am bound for glory.
lot to celebrate and all that we have in Jesus Christ. And I want to add my happy Father's Day to all the fathers out there. I love being a father. It's one of the greatest joys in life. And, you know, sometimes as a father, we have responsibilities. We should, right? We should have responsibilities. And one of the responsibilities as a dad, as a husband, is the lawn at my house needs to be mowed on a regular basis. And are there any fathers out there that really love to keep a good lawn? Not a lot. Okay, great. You know, so that's okay, because we, at a time here not long ago, we had this kind of drought thing going on where the lawns were parched, right? You know that. And if you try to keep a green lawn, man, good luck. You know, I had to water it every day. And then last Sunday, I walked out of the house in the morning to go lead worship up at our Dalton campus. And when I opened the door, there was water on the ground. And it was crazy because we hadn't seen it in a few weeks. And it was just so refreshing. I just remember a feeling of just being refreshed because there was just fresh, clean, new water. And as I was driving there to lead worship, I was thinking, you know, it's a lot. It's not unlike our spiritual lives, where sometimes there's seasons of drought, if we're honest. There are those dry seasons, and it's tough. There are those tough moments where it can be hard to connect with God. It can seem that way. And that's why I love these moments together every week, that we get to come together as the body of Jesus, as the body of Christ, and celebrate together what we know to be true, even in the midst of the things that are tough, the dry seasons of our lives. We get to have these regular reoccurrences of truth celebration that feeds our hearts and refreshes our soul, the rain of God's grace seeping into the hearts that are sometimes dry, that need it so badly. And I love this quote that I came across. It's by Jason Meyer in a book that he wrote. Don't Lose Heart is the name of the book. And I think we're going to pop it on the screen for you. Maybe. Maybe not. But he said this. He said, just as there are unreached lands that need the gospel, there are unreached places in my heart that need the gospel. And so today, maybe for you, it's been a bit of a dry season. Maybe it hasn't been. But perhaps there are some unreached places that you've kind of kept the message of the gospel, the full acceptance of you in God's sight through Jesus' perfect sacrifice. That means you're fully forgiven, fully loved by Him, and that'll never change. Maybe there are places in your heart that need to remember that today as we celebrate. So we want to sing about our one and only Savior, our one and only Jesus, and celebrate with us as you do. I have been saved by the grace of God, amen. I have been raised to a future without end. I set my eyes on a true and loyal friend, the one whose life I'm hidden in. Lift it up, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. All my hope in Jesus, love that never leaves us. You won't forsake us now, only Jesus, faithful through the ages. Of all my joys, the greatest. A place in the family of my God, I will be named. When the saints go marching on, He is the prize. My salvation and my song, the only
what I'm counting on. Oh, Jesus, all my hope in Jesus, love that never leaves us. You won't forsake us now, only Jesus, faithful through the ages. Of all my joys, the greatest, the one and only Jesus. Now to him be the glory, who is able to do more than we could ask or imagine. Amen, amen. Now to him be the glory. Let his people shout his victory through all generations. Amen, amen. Amen, amen. Jesus, all my hope.
Something we can count on today.
I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. He's working all things out. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Yes, I will. I count on one thing. The same God that never fails will not fail me now. You won't fail me now in the waiting. The same God who's never late is working all things out. In his time, he's working all things out. Oh, yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand against. And I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand against. I choose to praise, to glorify, glorify the name of all names.
Yes, we do. that nothing can stand against, and I choose to praise, to glorify the name of all names, that nothing can stand against. Sing it out now, yes. Yes, I will lift you high in the lowest valley. Yes, I will bless your name. Oh, yes, I will sing for joy when my heart is heavy for all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Yes, I will for all my days. Oh, yes, I will.
And Lord, as we now prepare our hearts to receive your word, and we know that sometimes that what you're asking of us is something that our hearts would naturally say, no, I won't to. But we want to purpose that our attitude will be submission, that we will receive your truth, and that we will say that response, that even when times may be difficult, what you're calling us to is very, very good. And so, yes, God, yes, we will. We'll listen and obey, and help us to do that by the power of your Spirit. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys can have a seat.
Happy Father's Day. Isn't it great? I don't know if you know the history. I think it was, I'll probably get the years wrong, in 1908, a mother thought it would be great to honor mothers, and about 12 years later, it became a national holiday. 2 years after she designated that, another young lady wanted to honor her father in 1910 and come up with Father's Day, and it took 6 decades to make it official. I don't know what you all got, but we're getting beef jerky. So I suppose this is a day, fathers, that you have some given rights. That work? So what's a right that you think you have today because you are father? Get to pick the food. Get to cut the grass. I have a boat. We don't have grass like that. What's another right you have? Lot hugs. There you go. Somebody else. Come on, fathers, this is your day. Claim it. You only get one. It's not like we get the rest. What's that? You get to hit a golf ball? I can't hit a golf ball, but I like it. So I'll ask you this question. What rights would you be willing to give up? Stand up. I'm seriously, stand up. Everybody, stand up. Turn to someone and have a discussion about what rights you would be willing to give up. Fathers, I'm particularly, ask a father, today on Father's Day, what right would they have that they would give up? Go. Tony just texted me.
Good night, sleep. Oh, whatever. Happy Father's Day, but yeah. Don't ask that.
Okay. Go ahead, have a seat. So what, somebody give me something that was like completely like out of blue. You didn't see it coming, you wouldn't have seen it if it was a freight train. What was it? A right that you would be willing to give up. I'm not sure I heard it correctly. I don't know if I wanted to hear that correctly. Boy, you're stretching me. I love it. I love it. So I want you to, we live in a world that's in a rights fight. We're fighting about rights. all kinds of rights are we talking about? And everybody thinks they have a right about this or that. And we're going to talk today about rights. Our willingness to give up a right. Does it fit your character that when you have something that it's right for you to do, that you have a right that was given to you somehow, that you would be willing to set that right aside? I don't know if you know about this, but the first temptation to mankind in the garden was all about rights. A slinky, sneaky, slimy of a guy came up to Eve and said, "Do you not have a right to have that fruit from that garden?" And convinced her that she had a right. So I want you to think about this. This might be one of the hardest messages I've had to prepare because I realize I'm probably hypocritical about these things. We have started off here with this Peter thing about all of this, and he's now getting into this concept of what rights would you be willing to give up if it allowed you to look like Christ? And that's where he's going. If you're new with us or you're just visiting for this time for the holiday, Peter wrote a letter to a church that was having persecution problems, and they had to live out their Christianity in front of people, and they found out the people that they were living in front of were quite hostile to them. And so he wrote this letter to help them how to live in a world that was counterculture to their Christianity, but it might be better to say their Christianity was counterculture to the world. And so his solution was that you and I would live out in front of the world around us the glories that we've been given in Christ. We're going to talk about one of those glories today, and it's amazing what he draws as far as something for you and I to think about in regards to our rights. And it's probably going to hit every person in here, even though the text is limited to one particular group of society. But I think the point of what Peter is trying to say here is, we are all in this, and take a look at this, and I want you this morning to consider the rights you have and what right you would not give up. If you could do it, if you had to do it, what would that look like if it was for you to honor Christ? So the theme verse that I've picked out in all this is that what Peter says, we're going to get to this in a couple, next month, I think. Have no fear when you're in trouble, when you're suffering. But in your hearts, honor Christ the Lord and always be willing to give an answer of the reason that's hope that's in you with meekness and with fear. And that's that gentleness with respect, meekness and fear. That's what he wants us to do. So the question is, each week I've been asking, has this week someone come up to you and say, "Wow, why do you act so different in this world? Why are you like this? Why do you act different?" Think about the rights thought about that. Would you be willing to give up a right if it made it look where you had hope in Christ and not hope in something else, rather than claim your right so that you could have your right, but maybe not represent Jesus Christ? How many times do we claim our rights, and yet at the same time, what we don't realize is we're not honoring Christ? That's what Peter is about to do. He has introduce this segment with the last verse of the last segment, and that's this: live honorably in front of the Gentiles. The word Gentile here is a general statement for anyone who's non-believer. That's what he's using. So how do we live honorable? Last week we looked at it this way. In order to live honorable, that means we have to live in a world different than the world. We tap out of the world. We leave the world. Instead, last week we found this, that we live before them by living within their institutions, the government, all the authority of the government, by submitting to them. That's what we learned last week, that it's unusual to find people who submit to authority, especially when we see the authority wrong, or we think it's wrong, and that was quite unsettling for all of us. At least, I think I read that, and then I had several of you come up afterward and say, "Yeah, that was very unsettling." And I found out, I was very much rejoicing, you were not mad at me, you were upset at Peter. Which is great, because you can take that up with him when you get there. Don't take it up with me. If you think that was bad, Peter is doing this. Government, where you work, next week you're going to love this, your home. So So don't come next week if you're not liking the theme of Peter. Did I just say that out loud? Government, work, home. He is trying to say to us, if you really want to live your life, he's going the opposite of what you and I would think. We would think home, work, world, government, institutions. He's going backwards because he's trying to drive a point here. So last week, again, the big idea, or this week, sorry, this week the big idea is, I'm going to give it to you ahead of time. Living honorable before the Gentiles means no longer live in the world like the world lives. We tap out. Solution two, he's going to say, we give up our earthly rights and walk like God intended. So I ask you again, what earthly right would you be willing to give up in order to walk like God intended? That's the question before us. I'm going to go through the text. It's quite long. We're not going to get to everything in it, which really messes me up in my head, but we're going to get through what I think we can. Take a look at the verses as they unfold, understanding the theme. I believe he's saying, give up your earthly rights in order to live like Christ in the world. Watch. Servants, be subject to your masters with all respect, not only to the good and the gentle, but also to the unjust. Now, he's going to go through and give us four fours. The word for here in the Greek is gar. It's like an evidentiary phrase. Because, here's my evidence. He's going to give us four fours in this, okay? Now, I happen to think he gives us four reasons, but I added a fifth just because I think I'm missing it. Never mind, that's my thought. So, focus on the fours. So, here's the first four. Here's the reason you and I should live with people, masters, who don't show us respect. We should show them respect. This is a gracious thing when mindful of God, one endures that's a hard word for me to pronounce, so you say it. One endures, thank you, while suffering unjustly. Okay, got that? That's the first four. Second four, for what credit is it when you sin and you are, I don't know if this happens to anybody in here today, are beaten for it, you endure. But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing in the sight of God. That's the second four. Third four. For to do this, for to this you have been called, because Christ also suffered for you, leaving you, love this word, an example, so that you might follow in his steps. He committed no sin, neither was deceit found in his mouth. When he was reviled, he reviled not again. When he did not vile in return. Sorry, I memorized this in the King James years ago, and this is the ESV, and I'm having trouble in my head. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but continued entrusting himself to him who judges justly. He himself bore our sins in his body on the tree, on the cross, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds, you have been healed. Four. We were strained like dumb sheep. I'm sorry, that's commentary. We were strained like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of our souls. This is heavy stuff. How many of you work for someone? How many of you work for someone? I didn't see some teenagers raising their hand. Did you raise your hand? No, I saw that. I caught that. Anna, did you raise your hand? Because you're an obedient daughter. Okay. I'm watching you. Think about this. We probably all work for someone. Now, here's a really complicated one. Is there anybody in here who works for somebody in here? Okay, but he's your dad, right? Okay. You do, right? Because you do. Who do you work for? You. Oh, no, you don't work for me. Is there anybody else that works for somebody in here? Okay. You work for Jeremy? Really? This is going to be awesome. You work for somebody in here? I work for your mom. You work for my mom?
Yeah.
I don't think I can follow that. My mom's dead. Okay. We'll go with that. You work for him. Does anybody else work for somebody in here? Yes, you work for who?
Joe Biden.
Nice. And you work for somebody in here? You work for Jeremy too? How many people work here for you? Oh, this is going to be so good for you today, my friend. I'm telling you. Okay? So, and then you guys work for Josiah, right? Because I caught that earlier. Josiah, where are you at? Yeah, you didn't raise your hand real quick. Okay. So watch how this unfolds. This is really great stuff. This is some of the most practical stuff you're going to find in the Bible. We're going to probably think it might be a little antiquated simply because of one little aspect that I'm going to spend too much time on, but we'll get to it. So let's go to the first verse that we're going to look at. And the first thing that throws us off is servants. Some translations would even say slaves. And I know that really conjures up all kinds of things in our society today. I want to try to go through this a little bit to help you with what he's talking about. And then since it's written to servants who are subject to their masters, I doubt that seriously anybody in this room actually thinks they go to work as a servant for a master. Somehow your kids are looking at me like, no, that's a true thing. So think about this. And the context is going to make us a little squirrely in our heads, but I think we're okay as we go through it. First of all, understand in the first century, the word servant and slave was a little different than what we have in our context today in regards to what the Civil War was over here. Although I think there are some certain similarities to that, and that is that one person is subservient in a kind of an oppressive way to somebody else. And that certainly is something we have to look at. Most of the time, by the way, Becca, in Rome, in the Roman culture, there was about 50 million people. Anywhere from 10 to 20% were slaves. So that would be 5 to 10 million people would have fit this category. Much of the early church, the people who first came to Christ, were first and foremost slaves. They were mostly Jewish people who became in servitude or slave to the Roman people. So understand, the church, as he's writing, he's actually writing to the members of these churches, and most of them probably at this point in time were made up of slaves. So think about that thought process. So some of them were slaves because they were prisoners of war. Some of them were slaves because their mother was a slave, and they simply were born into slavery. Some of them were slaves voluntarily, and this is a large portion of this group, to pay off a debt that they incurred that they could not do, so they said, hey, I'll just go to work for you type of thing, such as Jeremy has with his children. There is in the Roman culture, the Greek-Roman culture, an acceptable societal normative about slaves. This was not something that was even talked about as right or wrong in those mindsets. They did not have our interpretation as when we think of slavery. You have to put that in that context. Now, I'm going to get back to that in a moment. This is very interesting. This individual, don't know him personally, okay, but he asserted the only distinguishing thing between a slave and a beast or a cart is that the slave could talk. Now, you think you don't even know this guy probably as a nobleman in the Roman culture, but you will know this next person. This is Aristotle, and I've come across, I've read most of Aristotle's ethics, and it's amazing. We quote Aristotle and Socrates. We think they're such great men. This is actually his belief. A slave is a living tool, and a tool is an inanimate slave. That's how they thought of individuals in those days. And we could get a lot into this, but we won't from a societal point of view. I want to stick with the text and just watch what it says, okay? Neither Jesus nor the New Testament writers confronted the idea of slavery as a social ill. Instead, get this is so important if you read the whole New Testament. Instead of looking at it as a social ill, they talked about the ill that's inside the master and the slave. It was a hard issue for God. It was a hard issue for the New Testament writers. We're not suggesting that God is in favor of slavery. What he did is he did not address in the whole New Testament writing from a societal point. He never writes, let's have an uprising. He writes, let's figure out what's wrong with our hearts that's causing this. Because he knew what? Jesus knew what? And the New Testament writers knew what? If you fix the heart, what happens? Everything else changes. We are, don't get me wrong, I am as much opposed to these kind of things in our society that happen that are bad, but the bottom line is the fight is what? Our hearts. And you have to see that in this text because that's what he's going to talk about, okay? So just a couple of verses that, again, you can go throughout the New Testament and see this. Bondservants, obey your earthly masters with fear and trembling, with sincere, what? Heart, as you would Christ. Not by the way of eye service or people pleasers, but as bondservants of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart, rendering service with God, goodwill as to the Lord and not to men, knowing that whatever good anybody does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether he is bond or free. One more. Masters, this goes right after this in Ephesians. Masters, do the same and stop your threatening, knowing that he who is both their master and yours in heaven, that there is no partiality with him. So understand that what the New Testament writers are doing is not talking about the ills of society. They're talking about the ills in the nature of man, because God knows if they become believers in Christ, what will happen? We will live noble, beautiful lives full of God's glory, and when we do that, none of this even will be equated. This is in a Bible study. This is where we would stop and have a long discussion. And I can't. I have to move along. I hope you got that. Think of the book of Philemon, and this is your assignment when you leave. Read the book of Philemon, short 20-some verses. Philemon was a master, and his slave Onesimus ran away, apparently stole something from Philemon. Onesimus got caught, got thrown into prison, and wouldn't you know it, he gets chained next to a guy named Paul. I mean, if you're going to get run away for stealing and thrown into jail, you do not want to be next to Paul. Paul leads him to Christ, and he then gets out. Onesimus gets out of prison, and he says, go back to Philemon. What? Go back to Philemon. What? Go back. I'm sending a letter with you. The letter is to Philemon. Can you imagine Onesimus opening up the door with a letter from Paul? He comes up, and he hands it to Philemon, and God says, or Paul says to Philemon, forgive him. And if he has stolen anything from you, I'll pay it. Philemon, give up your rights. Take Onesimus back. Paul says, I'll pay it. That's the book of Philemon. Is that not a great story? I probably should just end right there and we go home. Except we have much more to do. Here's some complications in the early Christianity. What happens when a slave who had no rights becomes a believer and enters the kingdom of God with all the rights that Peter has now said to us? Do you remember what he said? We are what? Somebody tell me something he said in the beginning of chapter 2. End of 1, chapter 2. Come on. Help me out, because this is going to make me feel really good as a teacher that you've grasped this. We are a chosen race. Thank you. What did you say? Elect. Holy people. I'm not going to keep coming back to you. A royal priesthood. What happens to a slave who is at the bottom? By the way, the slave was at the bottom, at the same level as a donkey or a piece of wood or a wrench. I don't know if they had wrenches, but you get my point. Peter has just told them, you are a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a chosen people that I have purchased with my own blood. What happens to them in their mind? When they are told by their government, by the people who own them, you are nothing, but yet Peter just said, you are everything in Christ. Think about that, how that must have happened. What would you do? Would you want to flex? How about this? What happens if a slave becomes a believer and then his or her master becomes a believer? That would be something, wouldn't it? What if, on the other hand, the slave had become a believer and is now an elder in the church and the master comes? So now I'm going to ask a different question. Does anybody in here work for somebody out in the world? In other words, you have to submit to them. But in the church, they have to submit to you. Anybody? Would that not be cool if we had that? Do you see what I'm saying? It'd be like, Jeremy, you come in here, and I work for you, but I'm now the elder of the church. You would have to submit to me. Monday through Friday, I'd have to submit to you, but you'd have to submit to me on Sunday and Monday and Tuesday. No. That's the complication we have right now. This is what was happening in the early church from a historical point of view. This is tension in the body of Christ. How do we handle this? Be subject to your masters with all respect. Masters is this word, despot. It means, like, Putin is acting as a despot, as an authoritarian king, and trying to do whatever he does. That's what that word means. Masters had the equivalent of being the emperor in their world. In fact, when we do next week, when we talk about wives, submit to your husbands. Thank you so much for letting me teach that. It'll be so much fun. Hi, babe. Men were the masters, the superior emperors of their home. The master was the superior emperor over his or her, his agricultural business. You are the emperor. Feeling good? I don't know why I'm picking on you, but it's because you got seven people here working for you. Okay? So, they had absolute power and control. Absolute power and control. No question. You could not question anything they would do. Be subject to your masters with all respect. The word respect is phobos. It simply means they were to live in awe. Philippians 2:12, work out your salvation with all phobos, all fear and trembling. You and I are supposed to submit to those over us in leadership, in our where we work, if we make that connection, in great fear and awe, the same as we fear what God has done in our lives. I don't know if I've ever worked in my entire life in a fearful way of the person over me, other than Sergeant First Class Llewellyn. I could probably take him today. He's probably 95. And then I doubt it. He's probably making his great-grandchildren do push-ups at this very moment, so I will not mention his name again. I feared the man, Phobos. I don't know if I respected him, but I feared that gentleman, okay? Think about this in our lives. If we just stopped here and put a bookmark in it and said we're done for the day, what would you do with that passage right there? You and I do, when we have EEOC violations, when we have union contracts, when we have no negotiated agreements, and we have people working for us under HR worlds, do any of you have in your hand, do you have in your handbook? This would be cool. Slaves, be subject to your master with all respect. Yeah, you could do it. You could say 1 Peter 2:18, and I know you run your business by God's word. Is this not complicated? Think about this. Think about what he is actually saying here to us. Now he goes on, not only to the good and the gentle, but also to the unjust. The good and the gentle means they are so awesome to work for that they give you these tremendous benefits of world, and they are just gracious, gracious, gracious people. How many of you work for those type of people? Close your eyes quick. How many of you work for that kind of person? Oh, my gosh, hands up all over the place, okay? Think about that. Do you work for some? Would you say, my boss is, the two words, goodness and gentle, make up what we would call magnanimous. How many of you work for a magnanimous person? They're just all over the place. Jeremy, everybody back there, these guys up front, they're related to you, so they don't have to answer. Okay. Think about this. Have you ever described anybody you work for that way? I think there's some. I remember this, by the way, this whole passage is where I live every day. I coach leaders on how to lead people. That's what I do. I coach leaders on how to lead followers. I don't know if I've ever had a follower I've interviewed who said, you know what? I work with just the greatest, awesomest, magnanimous person in the world. Never had that happen. Or to the unjust. Now, a quick look at this. The transliteration of this word, this Greek word, is scoliosis. Okay, we've got some medical doctors here. Doc, tell me what scoliosis means. Crooked. Yeah, my daughter has scoliosis. Her spine is not straight. It's crooked. That's what it means. Some masters were crooked and perverse. The same thing applies whether it's the magnanimous master or the crooked and perverse master. He is saying to the audience of the body of Christ, work with them and be subject to them with great awe and respect. Is that not just profound to you, that's actually in the Bible? Do you think that we go to work and we look at our bosses and our people who lead us in this kind of framework? Imagine if you did when everybody, okay, don't run this on the camera. Somehow don't make sure nobody's hands are seen here, okay? How many of you have ever been at work and your boss is such an idiot? You've talked to other people about how he or she is such an idiot. Suddenly, hands up all over. I mean, think about this. Think about this. Have you ever got yourself at lunchtime talking about the foreman or the person above you and you're like, oh my gosh, this guy, oh, what there, she's a... Have you ever been in the same congregation and say, sorry, I think they're magnanimous. I'm going to give them awe and respect. You don't think Peter's challenging us in a great, powerful way right now? This is not me saying this. I'm telling you, I work for some idiots and I call them idiots. I'm probably going to pay for that. Think about what he's saying to us. Let me just go on with a couple more. By the way, Philippians 2:15, we live in a crooked and perverse generation. That's what he's talking about. That's how crooked it is. Some thoughts to consider. We are not slaves, but we are often in roles where we are treated unjustly. In these times, I want you to think about this. God may be asking us to consider tapping out of our own personal rights. Paul claimed his rights as a Roman citizen. He tapped out. Think about that. He tapped out of the Jewish persecution in order to tap in to his Roman citizen. There, we have a conflict here because guess what he did? He claimed his rights. He actually told, however, the Corinthians, don't allow yourself to be defrauded. No, he didn't. He said, allow yourself to be defrauded. Most of the time, he really said, you're going to court in front of Gentiles? Why do you do that? Allow yourself simply to be defrauded. He's saying, give up your rights. I have a very personal one with this, where I had to make a decision, and I just had to give up my rights and say, no, go ahead, I'll be defrauded. Think about what this looks like. Do you see what Christianity is asking us to do? Christianity is putting a big burden on us of how we live and negotiate our lives in this world today. It's counterculture to the world. If you go to work, you have all kinds of rights. I'm not suggesting, by the way, this is clear cut. I'm saying this is very confusing for us. When I go to work, I work with people. In fact, this week, four people either quit or were fired in front of me. And I'm there to either help them or help the person who fired or whatever. I'm there to walk them through this. I can tell you, two of them were believers. And those believers, I gave them this passage. And they're like, whoa, this is really hard, David. I'm like, I know. Two of them were not believers. If I would have even suggested this passage, they would have shot me. They were looking, hey, you think I should get a lawyer? Do you want to get a lawyer? Do you think you have the right to get a lawyer? Yes. That's probably a decision you probably want to make. I'm not a lawyer, so I have no idea. I just want you to know, this is like real life stuff here. This is people who are at work and they're being hurt. Do they claim their rights? If you're a believer, do you claim your rights? I'm not suggesting I have the answer. I'm suggesting watch what Peter says. So we're going to go from here. He has four gars, four fours. I think one of them has two points that we're going to get out of it. So we're just going to go through this. And you write these down, or you can get this off the QR code. I just want you to think about them and understand this is what Peter is saying to you. I'm not going to elaborate much on it. I'm going to give you, we're just going to go through those verses, and I'm going to draw a conclusion from what I think is there. And inside of this, there's such a magnanimous, perfect, wonderful little truth that's just going to blow us away. So here we go. The first one. For this is a gracious thing, when mindful of God, one endures sorrow, yes, while suffering unjustly. The word gracious thing means it's an act of God's grace in your life to endure suffering. That's what he's saying. It's an act of grace. When you and I have a mind toward God, motivation number one, if you and I want to live in this world where the world will say to us, why do you live like that? And ask us the reason of the hope that's in us, you and I will have a mind that is set toward God about enduring life's sorrow and suffering. Does that come natural to you? It doesn't come natural to me. Does anybody hear that this comes natural to? I'd be anxious to see it. Where by God's grace, you and I have a mind of God to endure life's suffering and sorrows. Most of the time, if we're in suffering and sorrows, what do we want it to do? Stop. This word enduring means to bear under, as in a continuous moment. We have to have a mind toward God. Now, what does that look like? This is actually a real question. What does it mean to have a mind toward God? Be mindful of God. When mindful of God, one can endure sorrow with suffering. Say it again. Prayer and supplication. Mind on eternity. You recognize the goodness that's inside of it, or in all of it. Oh, His goodness. Thank you. Very good. His goodness in all of it. Lean on His strength. I think all those things are great. I think there's one thing I'm going to add to it. Do you realize that God's entire intention when He created the world was to allow His Son to suffer by design? God's mind created a world in which sin would enter in, and the only way to redeem man from sin was for God in His mind to put His Son where He had to endure the greatest suffering. That's having a mind of God. You and I think about it this way, I would think. I knew. I shouldn't talk for you. I think of it this way. David should not have to do any suffering. I think everything should be great. I think every day should be Father's Day. And Robin would go, he always does. Every day should be special for me. I shouldn't have any suffering. Do you realize that God's whole entire plan and whole entire intent is to use suffering in order to bring us redemption? In fact, A.W. Pink said it this way, quit looking around and start looking above. Can you imagine? I don't know if any of you are in contracting for a new service. I do this all the time. I have to contract with potential clients and try to create a contract. Can you imagine in the middle of the contract, you are less concerned about your benefits, you're less concerned about all this, and all you're concerned about is what God is going to be able to do with you in that group. What are we normally nervous about? We're nervous about all these things of the earth, and He is saying to us, be mindful of God, and I think it is mindful of His activity. I think all the things you said, but it is also be mindful like God about what suffering is for. And you're going to see why I believe that's true as we go through. Motivation number two. For what credit is it if when you sin and you are beaten for it, you endure? He's just making a logical argument. He's not saying it's okay to be beaten. He's trying to make an argument here. But if when you do good and suffer for it, you endure, this is a gracious thing. Again, here we go. This is a God's grace in the sight of God. A second motivation for us to do this work, to live like this in front of the world, is that we are doing this in the sight of God. Okay, let's go back to the original question that I said a little while ago. How many of you have ever talked about your boss when they're not in the room? A few of you are raising your hand. The rest of you are sitting on your hand so you don't expose yourself. How many would talk about your boss if they were in the room? In a bad way. We would not. I've only seen that happen a couple of times, and then the person who talked about the boss in a bad way was no longer in the room. If you get my point. We would never do that. I don't know if you caught the passage from Ephesians, but we are to live our lives in a work situation as though we are working for whom? This is what it means in the sight of God when you compare the other passages that Paul wrote. He's not talking about simply that God is omniscient and sees everything. He's talking about the fact that we work and we live in the sight of God. You may not like how I do this. My only criticism when I leave here, my only question when I leave here is, did God like what I did here? You go to work every day. The question is, and I do this for a living, as you know, I speak in front of people. I want them to be happy, but when I leave, I have to ask this question. I just did that in the sight of God. Is that, did I work in the sight of God? We are motivated to live this way because we have a mind of God that says, oh my gosh, God puts suffering in here for a unique point. And he wants us to live as though we are working in his sight for his pleasure. Is that not awesome? I don't go to work for this person or this person. How many of you said you work for Jeremy? Okay, they're dropping out, just so you know. No, you don't. You don't. You work for Jesus Christ and his glory. That is completely different than if I negotiate like the world. Oh, I'm here to work for this, and you fill in the blank. No, you do not work for them. You and I are so incredibly different in our work. I have told you time and time again that my job, I make a ton of money off people that have conflict in the workplace, and 80% of them are believers. I really don't want them to fix that because it's going to cut my income down. I'm joking. I'm serious. I think God had put me in this business. I lost the ministry because of the failing in our family. I went to work doing this, and I believe God, you have said to me so many times, David, you are in the ministry. God sends me to an organization, and I sit down with two people, and they're believers in Christ who hate each other. And right in front of the world, they act this way. No, right in front of Christ, they act this way. Folks, you and I cannot look like that. We have to leave here knowing when we go to work that we are have the mind of God because we think like he thinks and we have a life that we're living in the sight of God. It's a gracious, gracious thing he does. This is a long passage. I have to break this up. I can't do this. I think there's two points in here I'll do real quick. For to this you have been called. Okay, for those of you who want to get out of your suffering, read that again. For this you have been called. Sovereignty of God. God put some here. God's 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 put some here in societal work. Leaders, followers, middle managers, slaves. God put, he said, you have been called for the position you've been called, for the suffering that you have been given. That does not sound like a gracious God. Yes, it is. Yes, it is, because he only is using us to do one thing, and that is to bring the world to Christ. Leaving you as an example. Okay. Hoopa gromas. Say that with me. Hoop, like hula hoop. Hoop. Ah. Gra. Mas. Hoopa gromas. Hoopa gromas is only used here in the New Testament. It's used no place else. It's like Peter wrote up and created his own word. Hoopa gromas would be to take the Greek alphabet and trace it like this. You understand? How many of you learned how to write? I don't think they do this today, but okay, you're gonna. You had to follow a template, like a little plastic thing, and then you go home. Your mom and dad somehow got a hold of those suckers, so all night you were tracing. That's what hoopa gromas means. It means he left us a hoopa gromas, an example. I can't make an A by drawing zero. It doesn't work that way. You can't be a Christian and say you're Christ-like and not hoopa gromas, follow the pattern that Christ laid out for us. And this is why you're about to see what he's about to write. It's just the most marvelous thing that he's saying to us. This motivation, however, is God's grace. By God's grace, we will walk in the steps of Christ as his divine example. It says that we might follow in his steps. If you've never read A.W. Tozer's In His Steps, that's a good book for you to get, old one. So we are to live like the example of Christ. Hang on, not the example you think you should have. Sorry, dads. Not like the example of your father, earthly, sorry. We are to live our lives like the example of Jesus Christ, how he would have done it. So Peter goes on and says, let me tell you what those steps look like, okay? For when he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he did not threaten. He continued entrusting himself, this is so huge, to him who judges justly. He himself bore his sins on the cross, that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds we are healed. By God's grace, you and I walk because we are trusting the judgment and the justice of God. little poll vote here. I don't have time to do a Kahoot up on the screen. How many of you think God is demonstrating justice in our world right now? You're like, okay, if God's so just, why is he allowing this to happen? Come on. This is where our walk of faith is so amazing. I wish I could get deep into how this affected my life. Allowing yourself to be defrauded, allowing yourself to be hurt, allowing yourself to be treated and maligned because you knew ultimately the God of justice will prevail and give you deliverance and do what he thinks is right in justice. Is that not an amazing walk with Christ? Because guess what Christ did? Do you see what's right in the middle of all this, folks? If they would have accused you wrong and threatened to put you on a cross, what would you have done? How many of you would lawyer up? How many would run to another country? How many of you would hide in seclusion? He allowed himself to be taken captive, cursed, demeaned, defrauded, and destroyed on the cross. And you and I complain that we don't get what we want at break. You and I complain that we don't get the salary we want. Do you see what Peter has done? This has nothing to do with slavery. It has nothing to do with masters. This has to do with the heart. Do you realize that the middle of the gospel is the answer to all this? Jesus Christ claimed no right. None. In order to set an example and to, more importantly, to redeem us, and by his wounds, you and I were exonerated of all sin. Is that not awesome? Right in the middle of this story of the master and the slave, Peter weaves in the gospel, and remember, Peter was there that day. Peter denied Christ that day. Four, we are straying like sheep, but have now returned to the shepherd and overseer of our souls. By God's grace, stop wandering like dumb sheep and start trusting in the overwatch of God. How many of you believe that your hand is in, you are in the, don't raise your hand here, but do you honestly believe that you are in the palm of God? Palm of God's hand. Do you believe that? Do you think one day he woke up and go, oh my gosh, I forgot all about you, Jake, I'm sorry. He's like, oh, sorry, the little thing that happened, car accident, I'm so sorry. You think God does that? He has designed every warp and woof in our life. He is on overwatch. And he is the shepherd and overseer, episkopos. He oversees everything of our souls. There's nothing that David has been brought through. And I've got all kinds of junk that I've been brought through that God didn't first know and design in my life. And I rejoice. That's a motivation. I'm worried about whether or not this guy treats me right, this guy treats me right, this person treats me right, and God is up there going, I got all this, please. Yeah, they mistreated you. I'll take care of it. Just follow me. Just walk in my steps. Just follow my example. We can tap out if we develop a mind toward God, if we live in the sight of God, if we follow the example of God, if we ultimately submit to the justice of God, and if we relax and understand the overwatch of God. Paul said it this way in Philippians. Have this mind among yourself, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count, look at this word, is this not a great word for us? Did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped. But he literally emptied himself. The God of the universe allowed himself to be all his rights gone in order to be on the cross for each one of us who accept him by faith, being born in the likeness of man. He literally had to go through the birthing process. He had to go through diapers. He had to go through crying. He had to fall down. He had to get back up. I can see Joseph and Mary. Go ahead, Jesus. Get back up. We're not going to help you this time. He had to go through all of this. This is the God of the universe. Set every right aside in order for him to experience that so that he can represent you and I on the cross and redeem us. You can leave here today and reject all this you want, but the thing you cannot reject is what he has done for us in that way. Let me give it to you in a big idea. Living honorable before the Gentiles means we no longer live like them as they live in the world. We tap out. Instead, what we do? Rather, we give up our earthly rights and we walk like God intended. We walk in Christ's steps. Stand with me if you would, please. Father, you have given us just a tremendous set of words for us to look at. But they're not words. They're not Peter's idea of what might be nice in the workplace for where we go every day. They're written by your Holy Spirit, based upon your Holy Son, and based on your holy plan for our lives. Help us, Father, to be so unique in this world that we will leave here today and people will ask for the reason that is for the hope that is in us, and we can answer in gentleness and respect because we are walking in the steps of Jesus Christ. In your Son's name we pray. Amen.
No matter how we're feeling, God's way is always best for us. Let's remember that as we sing today.
When the weight of life begins to fall, on the name of Jesus I will call. For I know my God is in control, and his purpose is unshakable. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I see, my hope will always be your promises to me. Now I'm casting out all fear, for your love has set me free. My hope will always be your promises to me. As I walk into the days to come, I will not forget what you have done. For you have supplied my every need, and your presence is enough for me. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I see, my hope will always be your promises to me. Now I'm casting out all fear, your love has set me free. My hope will always be your promises to me. You will always be more than enough for me. You will always be more than enough for me. Gonna stop the plans you made. Nothing's gonna take your love away. You will always be more than enough for me. Sing that again. You will always be more than enough for me. You will always be more than enough for me. Nothing's gonna stop the plans you made. Nothing's gonna take your love away. You always be more than enough for me. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I see, my hope will always be your promises to me. Now I'm casting out all fear, for your love has set me free. My hope will always be your promises to me. Doesn't matter what I feel, doesn't matter what I see. My hope will always be your promises to me. Now I'm casting out all fear, for your love has set me free. My hope will always be your promises to me.
Celebrate that he gives life today.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Pour out our praise, it's your breath in our lungs.
Let's leave today with that song on our lips, and we'll just continue to celebrate Jesus as we go on into our week. Well, again, happy Father's Day. Enjoy the rest of your week. And also, if you're here today as our guest and you're here for the first time, we do have a gift for you at the Welcome Center on the way out, so be sure to grab that. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll see you next week. Take care.